We had gone ahead also.
Is this where we had stopped?
We have to start from syncretism, huh?
Okay. Syncretism. Right. Okay. So we were speaking of the various characteristic features of the idea of humanism and the processes that are involved therein. Speaking of them, we discussed a number of thinkers, number of causes. Just not able to go back to whatever. Yeah. And the characteristic features of humanism in the earlier part. Now we will move on to see a few more characteristic features of humanism, and then we'll go ahead with the humans, the men and very few women also, who manifested the thought and the various processes of humanism during the European Renaissance. Earlier we saw, did we discuss the Protestant thing?
Yes, ma'am.
Earlier we spoke a little bit about this individual spirit and what a human being feels, what is his or her experience, that getting importance. Here we, one can say that this is something which resulted in people trying to go beyond these little ponds of identity, these little limited limited groups of identities, which compartmentalize people into various religious sects, various regional identities, various family identities, so on and so forth, or national identities even. And people started thinking beyond these little kingdoms and thought of themselves as just humans. This is something that comes about in this period, thinking of people as simply humans. This is a very liberating kind of an idea, because it helps one understand even conflicting points of view from other people. So people started thinking that, okay, this such and such person feels that XYZ is not the way I perceive it, but he has a different version of that reality. But it's still okay. He is also a human being. I am also a human being. So at least I can try and understand what he or she wants to say. So this tolerance for other people's ideas, this compatibility of various ideas, this coexistence, different ways of living, different ways of thinking, is something which comes about in this period, and it is called as syncretism. The other part, the other point is also self-explanatory, really. Let me just underline the fact that people started marveling at, earlier we have seen the quote from Petrarch, wherein he says that he goes to this Mount Vento and says that the mount was scarcely a cubit high than the powers of human contemplation. So he feels that yes, nature is great, but the ability of a human mind to think, to create, to contemplate, all these abilities of the human mind are also equally, if not greater than what the nature has to offer. So people started marveling at, people started admiring the ability of the human mind, the wisdom of humans. This is something which again puts human beings at the center. And the three binaries that earlier we have seen, binaries between humans and society, humans and nature, humans and gods. So in all these binaries, humans during the Renaissance period start taking the center stage. They start getting into the focus, as it were, which leads to, of course, the various manifestations of human abilities and development of various branches of knowledge, new body of knowledge. This also leads to an emphasis on dignity of a human being. So earlier it was believed that how much ever you punish your body for being the sinners that we all are, you will never really atone for your bad deeds that you have done. And it is the Jesus Christ who has to come and kind of pay for your sins. Kind of that kind of a feeling of guilt was a watermark of the earlier ways of thinking. But now people start feeling that human beings have dignity and we are able to make something good out of our lives. This ability of human beings is something that people start having a great belief in. And hence it becomes a focus of a lot of contemplation, yes, but also different manifestations, achievements of human beings become a subject in itself of study. So this period witnesses the growth of various scientific disciplines such as anatomy, painting. We'll see the manifestations, different manifestations in the field of art. But studying the human mind, studying the human body, studying the human polity, studying the human economy start becoming important for these people, as against studying what the gods have to say, studying what the nature has to offer, or studying what the society has to say. So in all the three binaries, humans start taking the center stage. The picture, of course, is creation of Adam, wherein man as a creation of God, man as almost equal, pure creation of God, is taking an equal, almost equal play space in the entire frame of reference. This I'm not speaking only of this specific picture, but this picture is a representation of the overall attitudes of this Renaissance period, wherein people start thinking that man is an important and a valid subject of study, subject of understanding. Spirit of inquiry and criticism is something that is extremely important. Asking of questions, offering constructive and even destructive criticism starts becoming very, very relevant, very, very important, quite recognized as means of attainment of knowledge in this period. So people don't feel that such and such person is criticizing me and that is a bad thing. He's saying bad things about my work. They don't feel that anymore. They start, in fact, sharing their knowledge with other people so that it may be critically evaluated by peers. A large part of the scientific method that we follow today when we are doing our research, that is peer review and all those things, report writing, writing of footnotes, all these things have deep roots in this ideology of humanism. So even if you give a small footnote saying that such and such statement I have written in my essay really has been written by such and such person back in the 1970s, it only means that you are trying to be grateful, you are trying to give due credit to that person because you recognize the efforts taken by that person in creating that little piece of knowledge. So humanism has deeply affected the way we do things even today. That's what I'm trying to highlight here. Okay. Now, what becomes the primary source? Speaking of footnotes and bibliography, what becomes the primary source for all of us when we try to study various manifestations of the ideology of humanism. Still, the writings of people, but Asari's writings are very important about the painters working under the patronage 50. He's also somebody who's credited with using the word Rinascita, Rinascimento, Renaissance for the first time in print. Okay, then a little bit of a discussion about why is it and who are the why is it that the De Medicis are sponsoring all these endeavors of the Renaissance period one, and who are the De Medicis? De Medicis were the owners of one of the largest banks in Europe in this period. This is also a period, we are speaking of the 14th, 15th and the 16th centuries. This is also a period when people have, as we saw, they start going out. They start having voyages across the seas to, over a long distance. So De Medicis had this business at various port cities wherein they would encash promissory notes or what is called as hundis here. So you don't have, if you are a trader, you don't have to carry physically all the money that you have earned, let's say in Aden or in India or whatever place, not so early in India, but still in whatever place, you can simply write a promissory note and hand it over to the person in, let's say, Istanbul, and De Medicis will they will encash the promissory note for you in a place such as some big port city in the Mediterranean. So all across the Mediterranean Sea and even at inland places, De Medicis ran a huge financial empire. Now, we, if those of you who follow Marathi might have realized that the discussion was going on around the concept of interest on what is the right word for that? We earn interest when we deposit money in the bank, right? Banking is all about interest. How do the bankers have their profits? Through interest. Interest is a peculiar idea as far as Christianity and Islam are concerned. And it is considered not a very honorable way of earning your money if you are earning money only with the help of interest. Why would it be like that? Why interest, earning money through interest is not considered a meritorious thing? Question. Why Christianity and Islam feel that earning interest on your money that is deposited in a bank, or you have given given loan to somebody and you are taking interest on that loan, it's not considered as a good meritorious thing if you are following Christianity or Islam? Why?
Probably because you are not actually working for the returns.
Please elaborate.
Just that much.
Ma'am, yala, can we call this appropriation also, like in these terms, if the religion is saying that if you are taking interest, you are then also like appropriating someone's labor, kama?
Precisely. You are, appropriation is still a neutralish word. You basically stealing other people's labor. That is the idea in Christianity and also in Islam. Because as the example went in Marathi, suppose I don't have money to buy something today and I take money from Anushree, I take 100 rupees and after a month I return her 105 rupees. So 5 rupees is the interest that Anushree earns. But religion tells me, if I'm a follower of Christianity or of Islam, it tells me that Anushree has not worked for those extra 5 rupees. I have worked for those extra 5 rupees. So if I pay her 5 extra rupees, Anushree has earned a money out of no labor. Those 5 rupees are something that she has earned unfairly, is what is believed in Catholic Christianity and in Islam also. Is the concept clear? Why interest is considered as a bad thing? Conceptually, you may not agree with it, obviously. But is the idea clear?
Okay.
Everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, earning of interest is something that was considered a bad thing, and the Medicis were doing precisely that. The whole financial empire, which was based out of their banking business, was thanks to their business of writing and encashing promissory notes and charging interest to various people whom they financed on their voyages. Now, as time passed and the Medicis became more and more rich, they started looking out for the next best thing beyond money, and that is status. So you have the money, but people feel that you are somebody who's earning money using unfair means. What do you do in such a condition? You have money, but you don't have acceptance.
Charity, ma'am. Yeah.
Or we start being human.
Laughing.
Atone for the sins.
Yes, atone your sins by image building, basically. You start building your image so that people start accepting that such and such person is a very nice person because he or she donates money annually to such and such good cause. So one starts craving social acceptance. And the Medicis were also not any different. They started craving social acceptance, and out of the guilt that the money that they had earned was out of interest, out of this guilt, what happened was they started financing a lot of activities which would come under the title of charity in those days. Painting, undertaking a lot of work of construction of religious buildings, embellishments of existing buildings, that is decorations of existing buildings, is something that the Medicis sponsored in a big manner. At one time, they had Botticelli, Michelangelo, and Leonardo da Vinci working on their payrolls. Very rich people and prominent sponsors of what came to be known as Renaissance art. How rich and how prominent were the Medicis? They had 4 popes from their family and 2 queens of France coming in from their family. So these are big people, very influential, very powerful, and also now very prestigious. This is where we'll stop, and